needs to stay in good standing, relational forgiveness. Proper fellowship with God cannot happen with unconfessed sin in our lives. Okay? Don't think it can. It can't. Therefore, we need to confess our sins to God as soon as we are aware that we have sinned in order to maintain close fellowship with God. Now do you get the difference? Yeah. They're not getting judged for them in heaven. Okay? Thank God for that. But you will get disciplined down here for your sins. God, a good father always disciplines his children when they go off course. And why is it so important that you evaluate where you're at before, if you're going through something, to see if I'm still stained with sin and living in it. And I'm suffering the consequences for them actions. Amen. And then you can understand why this is happening.
Yeah.
Then you can't say, well, God, it's your fault. No, God didn't take away your free will. You can go, leave here, and sin up a storm, and God's not going to stop you. He's not going to stop you, but he will discipline you. Mm-hmm. Amen?
All right. Amen.
I just wanted to explain that to you, why we still have to go to the God and say, look, yep. Lord, I blew it, man.
Yeah.
Please, stay. I know you love me. I want to stay with you. I don't want to see the man I've been rising up in me again. Because our sins make us what? Bring our sin nature back. The dead man back to life again. Have you not noticed? You try to put him down and he comes back up. That's why spiritual growth is the key. So you can understand. I need to stay in good standing with God while I'm here. So the relationship doesn't suffer down here. Thank God up there. They ain't never going to suffer. Just imagine the unbelievers. They're not only getting judged down here for their sins, but they're going to get judged up there too, with the double whammy for them.
Yeah.
You know when people use that expression, correct me if I'm wrong?
Yeah.
Well, why don't you go to God the next time you think that you're right? Say, God, correct me if I'm wrong.
Amen.
And stop telling everybody else that they're wrong. Correct me if I'm wrong. Because people have their own standard of right and wrong. You're a Christian. You go to God and you ask him, correct me if I'm wrong, Father. And he's going to say, I love you and I'm going to. That's why you got people this way, that way, this way, all around saying, I'm right, no, I'm right, no, I'm right. No, only God is right.
Amen.
I don't know if I'm right. I hope I am. Only God's word is right.
Amen.
Remember what Paul was doing before he got converted? He thought he was doing the right thing. He thought he was right by persecuting Christians. He thought he was doing God a favor.
Yep.
Till he got knocked off his high horse. Said literally, yeah, that's where they get that expression. Where do you think they get that expression, knocked off your high, get off your high horse?
Yeah.
He got it from the Bible.
Yeah.
And turned him around. He thought he was doing the right thing. But he was all 100% wrong what he was doing. So let me tell you something. When you think that you're doing the right thing, measure it up to what the Bible says, and then you'll know if it's right or wrong. Everybody does wrong.
Yep.
Everybody does. Ain't nobody in this room that does right always, all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Can I get an amen for that?
Amen.
You can be real in church and take my church face off, man. I lived in hell all day.
Yeah.
That's good because God is changing me through it. We wish the blessings was lasted long as the adversities.
I know, right?
Well, you get that blessing and you're just like, whew, you get this little breathing room. But you better gear up because the counterattack is coming.
Yes.
That's a fact. Yes, it is a fact. Because that's biblical. Now, it says right here, go to 2 Corinthians 7. I hope I explained that good.
Yeah,
you did. 2 Corinthians 7,
you said? Yeah.
Yeah. See, the penalty of our sin was paid for at the cross. They were judged and paid for at the cross. But our relational sins down here, our sanctifications, are getting judged. He's judging us. He says, if you would judge yourself, you'd not have to get judged for me. So if you're not evaluating yourself, God's going to step in and do it. I'd rather just turn from it. You know?
Yes.
This ain't the way I got to do it. I got to repent. Why do I want to wait for the discipline of the Lord? I'd rather get led by the eye, not the rod.
Yeah, right.
The eye is the eye of God's word saying, no, don't go there. Mm-hmm. The rod is the discipline that comes from staying there.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Now, 2 Corinthians 7:1 clearly states, because we have these promises, dear friends, let us cleanse ourselves from everything that can defile our body and spirit. And let us work toward complete holiness. What is holiness? Holiness simply means separation. You are separating from your sinful nature. That's what holiness is. Separation from your sin nature. And living into your new, living in your new nature. Look what it says. Why? Because we fear God. Everybody knows, okay, when a father is going to discipline his kid, a good father, they fear him. There's a healthy fear for that.
Right.
Nick will tell you. Right?
Oh, yeah.
No, you have a healthy fear for him because you know if you stay there, you're going to hear it. You're going to get it. Mm-hmm. If you have a healthy fear of God, you'll understand if you stay there, you're going to get it. And good father, you're going to correct your kid. You're going to let him know because you love him. Get it?
Get it, yep.
Because we fear God. If you read your Bible and understand God, you should have a healthy fear for him. Because he loved the nation Israel, but he did a lot of things to them correct them.
Yes.
A lot of them died. A lot of them went into exile. A lot of them were imprisoned. He loved them.
Yes, he did.
All right. Here's the next one. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Look at verse 31. You know when you're going through something, you say, the devil's all over me? Devil's on me. Well, let me just tell you one thing. God let the devil on you.
Yep.
He has to allow him to get on you. And it says right here, look what it says. But if we would examine ourselves, which people hate to do, we would not be judged by God in this way. Yet when we are judged by the Lord, we are being disciplined, so we will not be condemned along with the world. Amen? He's disciplining us down here. So we're not condemned with the rest of the world. So there will be a separation here. Next principle. Forgive others and forgive yourself. This is so big. Jesus Christ forgave you of everything that you think, say, and do always. Do you have a hard time forgiving yourself when you fall short or you fail? You have to learn how to forgive yourself. Unconditional love. 1 Corinthians 13. Listen, forgiveness and consequences are two different things. Just because you're suffering the consequences, you still have to forgive yourself. The consequences might not get taken away, but you still have to what? Forgive yourself and move on. Now, don't allow bitterness to poison your heart, okay? And keep you stuck in unhealthy patterns. Instead, pray for the ability to forgive. Do you realize that you don't have that natural ability to forgive? You have to pray for forgive. Only God can give you that ability. Somebody hurts you really bad, does some real harm to you. You tell me you can forgive them. You say you forgive them until you see them.
Mm-hmm.
And you know this. Yeah, I forgive them, all right. Right? Listen, Ask God to help you move beyond challenges with confidence. Look, whatever happened in your life, you have to, when you wake up, the Bible says, when you wake up in the morning, whatever happened yesterday is clean slate with anybody. Clean, done. You know how freeing that is to live that way? Whatever happened yesterday is gone.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
My wife will tell you, I do it all the time. She said, what happened? I don't know, that was yesterday. Mm-hmm. Nothing I can do about it. Mm-hmm. All I can do is learn from it and not repeat it. Or pray for the person that hurt me so they don't hurt someone else. Mm-hmm. Look, if you can't forgive, you suffer for not forgiving. You know that, right? If you have unforgiveness in your heart, you all suffer for that. More than the person you're not forgiving. Mm-hmm. All right. Go to Hebrews chapter 12. See, I used to live by the world's principles in all kinds of things. At home, at work. Don't let anybody take advantage of you. Don't let anybody do this. Don't let anybody do that. Then the Bible says, no, you forget about what they're doing. You just concentrate on working for me. You go to work for me. You're going to get taken advantage of. You're a Christian. You're going to be taken advantage of down here. Mm-hmm. That doesn't matter. God knows that. He sees it.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Look what it says, verse 14. Work at living at peace with everyone. Mm-hmm. How can it be any clearer? Work at living with peace with only the ones I choose to live in peace with? No, it says everyone. Mm-hmm. If you're not living in peace with everyone, then you are not following the word of God. You are following your system or the world's system, which harbors hatred and bitterness. And that's from who? The devil. Work at living with peace with everyone. Because believe me when I tell you, everyone that's living on this planet was created by God.
Amen.
Amen.
Everybody. Yep. The ones you hate, the ones that are doing wrong, the ones that are ruining things, they all were created by God. And he's the one that will deal with them.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
Vengeance is mine, saith
the Lord. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. It said, people try to take God's place. I'm going to fix them.
Okay, sure.
Let's get rid of them all. Listen, the more you try to get rid of something, the more it grows. Read the Bible.
Yeah. Amen. I know that.
That's a fact.
They were doing it in Egypt, right? Let's kill the firstborn.
Yeah.
They're getting too strong for us. They couldn't do it. They were multiplying on top of multiplying. Let me tell you something. Only God can stop it. He's got the stop button, and he's got the stop button. Look at work at living a holy life. What's a holy life? A separated life. Separated from what people do. Look, for those who are not holy will not see the Lord. Now, people get trapped up with this now. We know that it doesn't require us to be holy to see the Lord in heaven. It's talking about your relationship with him down here. If you're living sinful and unseparated from the Lord, you're not going to see him down here. You're not going to see him. Look after each other so that none of you fails to receive the grace of God. Watch out that no poisonous root of bitterness grows up to trouble you, corrupting many.
Amen.
Look, we live in an evil world full of people that are trapped in evil, mm-hmm. that are under control of the evil one.
Yes.
Can I get an amen for
amen.
That?
Mm-hmm.
If you think that you're going to fix that, by doing something that's crazy, it's never going to get fixed. It's only going to get fixed when what? Jesus comes. He's the ultimate fix. You do your part. You don't participate in it. Mm-hmm. What do? You pray to the Lord. Mm-hmm. Remember Jonah? God said, I want you to go to the Nineveh. He told Jonah. And I want you to tell them about me. The judgment's coming if they don't turn. Jonah said, I ain't good. I hate the Ninevites. I hate the Ninevites. They skinned our people alive. They practiced everything. They killed. They were brutal. They were barbarians. Mm-hmm. Jonah went the other way. God says, no. No, you're not. You got stuck in the belly of a fish, right?
Yeah.
They threw him overboard.
Mm-hmm.
They said, what's going on? Jonah said, well, I'm going against God. That's why this is happening. He said, throw him over. Get rid of him. He knew why it was happening. He knew why the storm was coming, because he wasn't doing what God wanted him to do.
Mm-hmm.
So he was causing problems in his life. He does the same with us. You got swallowed up in the fish, right? You spit out again. God said, you go to Nineveh. Okay, Lord. I'm going. Look. There's a lot of people that we might not like, but it has no bearing on you telling them about Jesus.
Amen.
All those people got saved.
Yep.
They did. They turned back. They went back to him. But they, a few years went by and they did good. Then they turned back.
Yeah.
They got judged after
like
that.
Yeah.
But they got the opportunity to repent.
Yes.
And turn around. They did. Why? Because Jonah did what God told him to do in spite of how he felt about them. What is God telling you to do in spite of what you feel about other people?
Mm-hmm.
Are you running away from them? Watch out to no poisonous... You see what it says? A poisonous root of bitterness grows up to trouble you,
mm-hmm.
corrupting many. Look, bitterness doesn't just corrupt you. It says corrupting many. It corrupts a lot of people because you, when you're bitter, that it emanates off of you. You ever get around a person, all they do is complain? Because they're bitter. I don't know about you, can I already take it for a little while? And I gotta get out of there. Look, I already know that the world's a mess. You don't have to keep telling me that. I know there's a lot of problems. Hello, I see them too. You don't have to keep reminding me. I know they're there. You don't have to keep reminding yourself. They're there. But guess who else is there? Jesus is there too. Saying, I'm going to take you through it. This is only for a season.
Mm-hmm.
You have to go through this. I'm trying to refine you and turn you into something precious.
Mm-hmm.
I get an amen for that?
Amen.
He's always working. All right. Go to Ephesians 4 now. Now listen. You come to church and you read your Bible. But that has no bearing on you doing things God's way. You're getting a bunch of information. If you're not doing it, there's no transformation. Look what it says right here. Ephesians 4:31. Get rid of all bitterness. Whatever you have to do to clean bitterness out of your life, you have to do. You have to pray to God, pray to Jesus to forgive and heal. Look, get rid of all bitterness. Rage. You know that rage when you really get angry? Rage. Anger. Anger and rage are two different things. You could be angry that you see some little kid suffering because of an abusive parent. You have righteous anger in you. But rage is uncontrolled anger because you're not getting your way about something or you just don't agree with something. What's the next one? Harsh words. And slander. What is slander? I can't get this out enough.
Mm-hmm.
When you're talking about somebody that's bad, something bad about somebody, when they're not in your presence, to somebody else that assassinates their character.
Yes.
That is called slander, and God hates it. That's all the flesh. And don't come up and tell me that you're spiritual.
Mm-hmm.
If that's all you know how to do. Keeping this heart right for me is a 24/7 job. I ain't got no business. I ain't up in nobody else's business. I got enough of my own. Live and let live. I don't want to know.
Amen.
I don't want to know what's going on. Please don't tell me. Well, you know how our flesh is. We don't really want to hear it, but that's why it's a fight. It's a fight for righteousness. You understand what it is? You have to fight that, because you're going to want to hear something. Everybody wants to hear the juicy stuff about people.
Juicy.
Why would you want to like talk about something that's destroying somebody's life and hurt them even more? Instead of praying for them. It's right from the devil.
Look at your own life, yeah?
Yeah, look at your own life. Exactly. Your own life is brutal.
Amen.
Mind your business. My wife will tell you. She tells me, did you see that car down the street? What car? Did you see it? What, Nate? I don't see it. God sees it. I can live in peace down here that way. You understand? Mm-hmm. I already know there's all hell breaking loose all around me, but I'm trusting God. He's got me in the battlefield.
Yeah.
I'm dodging the bullets.
What did my neighbor tell
me? I'm really starting to enjoy it. I mean, I'm starting to enjoy traffic, too. Although today was really hectic on Mill Spring. I don't know what happened. I think everybody had spring fever. I went on Mill Spring Avenue. It took me like an hour to get, like, 2 miles.
Yep.
Everybody was up. Motorcycles, everybody was up.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? I don't know, man. I need to get to church. I need to get to church after that drive. I handle it well, but now I gotta get to church because I don't know if it's gonna end well. Amen? Now look what it says. As well as all types of evil behavior. Now, if the Bible is your owner's manual, this is what it's telling you to do. Get rid of bitterness. Get rid of rage. Get rid of anger. Harsh words and slander, as well as all types of evil behavior. This is what God's telling you to do. It's not mysticism. It's what? He's telling you right out what to do. You're under new management. God's saying this is what you have to do. Instead, you have to be kind to each other. Tender-hearted. Forgiving one another, just as God through Christ has forgiven you. He sends rain on the just and the unjust. God even blesses unbelievers. They're still alive and they still function well down here. Who am I to judge one? Whatever God's going to do, he's going to do. They're going to have to stand before him.
Mm-hmm.
When I stand before him, I want to hear, well done, my good and faithful servant. You minded your business.
Yeah.
And let me handle the business. You see, the world is God's business, not yours. Get quiet.
Yep.
You got people trying to save the world, right? You see what happens when all that happens, right? You got this one saying this is wrong. You got this one saying this is right. Then you got crazy people going even crazier than that, and crazier and crazier and crazier until somebody dies and suffers. Oh, that's real God. Because I'm right. All right. Mark 11. I hope I'm getting through tonight, am I?
Yeah, yeah. That's great.
Wonderful.
The Bible speaks to us. Look.